So I'm going to talk about the efficiency of Provably secure NTRU encrypt. So we saw two talks about signatures. Now we're going to talk about encryption. My name is Daniel Cabarcas, and this is joint work with Patrick Weiden and Johannes Buchmann. So public encryption based on lattices has attracted a lot of attention in the last decade, in part due to homomorphic encryption, but also to the need for alternatives to traditional public key encryption, standalone encryption. So public key encryption based on lattices, the scene looks a little bit like this. We have EncrypT, which is a very efficient public key encryption that was proposed in 96 by Hopstein, Pfeiffer, and Silverman. It is very elegant, very efficient, and it has survived almost 20 years unbroken, but it's not supported by a security proof. Then in 2005, Regev proposed the learning with errors problems, and he showed worst to errors case reduction from classical lattice problems to LWE. This is a very strong security guarantee. So schemes based on LWE have this very strong security guarantee. However, they are not very efficient. So in 2010, Lyubashevsky, Peikert, and Regev proposed a version of a similar scheme, but based on the ring-LWE problem. In this case, we have also a worst to average case reduction, but from ideal lattices, from classical problems on ideal lattices. But the schemes are more efficient. So great, but still not as efficient as NTRU. So it's still a challenge to find an encryption scheme that has this very strong security guarantee of a worst to average case reduction, and also as efficient as something like NTRU. There was Stehlé and Steinfeld in 2011 proposed a provably secure NTRU version, which seemed to answer a little bit this question of, seemed to go in that direction. It has a proof of security, a reduction from worst to average case reduction from classical lattice problems on ideal lattices. And it's very similar. The structure is very similar to NTRU. So the question we wanted to answer here is how far it closes the efficiency gap, how far it goes into closing the efficiency gap. I have to say, so the authors, Stehlé and Steinfeld, acknowledged that their scheme was not going to be as efficient as NTRU. They knew this, but we still want to know how far it closes the efficiency gap. Also, recently, in 2013, there was a paper by Boss et al. Where they implemented a homomorphic version of this PNE scheme, this probably secure NTRU version, and it seemed to suggest that PNE could be really efficient. So we wanted to really answer this question. But the truth is that it is not, that PNE is not efficient at all. The provably secure version of NTRU encrypt is not really efficient. And we came to that conclusion doing a thorough assessment of PNE. We show how to select parameters to instantiate a concrete version of PNE. We show how to calculate the practical security of PNE. We implemented the scheme, and in particular, we did we compared different Gaussian samplers to get to like the most efficient possible version of it, and then we compare the performance of PNE with that of NTRU encrypt and also with a scheme based on the ring-LWE problem like Lyubashevsky, Peikert, and Regev scheme. And finally, we analyze why PNE is really not so efficient. So here's an outline of the talk. I'm going to tell you quickly about PNE, how it works, how to select parameters for PNE, and how to calculate its security. I'll tell you a little bit about the implementation we did and show experimental results, and then analyze why PNE is not so efficient. So PNE is parameterized by integers M, P, and Q, and by real numbers R and S. The computation takes place in the polynomial ring over a quotient ring of the polynomials modulo x to the n plus 1. And this is done either modulo p or modulo q. And then the samples are taken from discrete Gaussians ds and dr. Ds is used for during key generation, dr during encryption. So there are two very different discrete Gaussians that are used. And just to give you an idea of how the parameters are going to look like, how big the parameters are, n could be around 2048. As we saw for other ring LWE schemes, this is much larger. N equals to 2048, so it's a bit larger than usual. Q is a 77-bit prime, so much larger than typical lattice-based schemes, but still much lower than, let's say, an RSA modulus. P equal to 2, this just determines the message space. And R equals to 36, this is the width of a Gaussian distribution, very typical for lattice-based schemes. And then S is 1.4 times 10 to the 16, very large for a Gaussian used in lattice. Just to give you an idea so that you know what we're talking about here. Key generation just as an NTRU, exactly as very similar to NTRU. We sample F prime from discrete Gaussian with parameter S, then compute F equals PF prime plus 1, so that F is equivalent to 1 modulo P. And if it's not invertible, it is resampled. Then G is sampled from a discrete Gaussian parameter S. Also, if it's not invertible, it is resampled. The secret key is going to be F. The public key is going to be H equals to P times G over F, computed in RQ, computed in R modulo Q. To encrypt, you sample two elements from this discrete Gaussian distribution with parameter R. This is E and E prime. And then you compute the ciphertext HE plus PE prime plus M in RQ. And then to encrypt, you simply compute F times C in RQ, and then reduce modulo Q and modulo P. The correctness of NTRU, of this version of the Provably secure NTRU, is very similar to this correctness of NTRU. It follows from the fact that when you compute F times C and substitute C, and then substitute H in, you get this expression. And if this expression is small with respect to the modulus Q, then there's no wrapping around. And then when you reduce modulo Q, you get exactly the same expression. It doesn't change. And so when you reduce modulo P, the first two terms cancel, and you get F times M, but F is equal to 1 modulo P, so you get M. Stehlé and Steinfeld showed that the scheme is secure as long as it is hard to find short vectors in a ring in a as long as it is hard to find short vectors on an ideal lattice. They did it in a couple of steps. First, they showed that for certain choice of parameters, H is statistically close to uniform. And then it follows that H times E plus P E prime is going to be very close to an instance of the ring LWE problem. And so from the worst to average case reduction from gamma SIVP to ring LWE, the security follows. Now, accomplishing both things at the same time requires to select parameters carefully if you want security and correctness. For security, AS needs to be chosen large. The parameter S needs to be chosen large so that H is really statistically close to uniform. But when S is large, then this expression is going to be very large because G and F are sampled from a discrete Gaussian parameter S. So you have to compensate by choosing a very large Q. This balancing these two forces is an important accomplishment of Stehlé and Steinfeld, but it's also one of the reasons why this scheme is not as efficient. So we move on to how to select parameters for PNE. We fix N to be a power of 2, P equals to 2, so that we have a reasonable message space and also a small noise. We use spherical discrete Gaussians, which is possible. It's OK. We set R equals to the square root of 2n over pi so that the worst to worst case reduction holds according to Regev. And then S is chosen to be 2n times the square root of ln 8nq times q. And this is, according to Stehlé and Steinfeld, what you need so that H is statistically close to uniform. Finally, we choose q in this interval where d is a constant, and we showed that if d is, if d is this around 25,000, then correctness, the scheme is correct with, I mean, there are errors with negligible probability. The details of these are in the paper. Now, using those parameters, we went on to calculate the security. We based the security on the distinguishing attack on LWE. We know that there could be better attacks, but it was outside of the scope of the paper to actually test what was the best attack. We just wanted some estimate for the security. All right, and according to we saw an expression similar to this in the talk before. According to Lindner and Peikert, using the distinguishing attack, an advantage greater or equal to epsilon requires time close to T sub epsilon, where the log of T sub epsilon is equal to this expression. A couple of things to notice here in this expression. One is that T sub epsilon is exponential in N. So it's good. It's secure. The scheme is secure. But more important, the log of T sub epsilon is proportional to 1 over log Q. So if you increase Q, the time for an attack decreases. And this is going to be important when we analyze the efficiency of the scheme. Then, since an attacker can choose epsilon at will within some reasonable range, we define the total time of an attack as the minimum of T sub epsilon over epsilon, where epsilon ranges in a reasonable range. And then we calculate that numerically. And assuming that a single block cipher encryption takes about 500 block cycles, the security of PNE is equivalent to a bit block cipher with B more or less the log of T plus 22, more or less. And using these estimates, we got some numbers for security and for the parameters. So those are the parameters. On the left, then we have advantage. We have the Hermit factors that, as we saw in the previous talks, determine more or less the security, the total attack time, and the equivalent bit security level. So 1.01, it's doable today, it seems, according to what Michancho said earlier on Monday. And so to get a reasonable security, we'll need at least to go to n equals 2048. All right. So then we went to implement this to see how efficient it really is. We did an implementation in C++ using NTL, using GMP. NTL uses fast Fourier transfer for the arithmetic in RQ. We did not touch that. We just used whatever NTL provided. And the only other thing interesting is how to sample discrete Gaussians. So we did a little bit of work on how to sample discrete Gaussians. We implemented four different methods for sampling discrete Gaussians. Rejection sampling, as described by Gentry, Peikert, and Vicuna Tan in 2008. The discrete ziggurat, as described by Buchmann et al. Inverting the CDF, as described by Peikert, and the Nux Yao algorithm by Nux and Yao. I'm going to tell you a little bit about each of them, just quickly, how each works to give you an idea. For rejection sampling, you simply cut the tails of the Gaussian, and then you sample a point in that area. If this point is above the curve, you reject it. If the point is below the curve, you accept the value of x, and that's what you return. Of course, this is discretized, so what you're sampling on the x-axis are integers. The discrete ziggurat is a more advanced way to do the rejection sampling. You break this area in a smart way. You break it into rectangles of equal area. And then when you're gonna sample, you sample first a rectangle, which rectangle you're gonna use. And you do that uniformly because they all have the same area. Once you are on a rectangle, you sample a point within the rectangle. If the point happens to be to the left of this point, you know that you can immediately accept it. If the point is to the left of this point, then you have to compute the value of the curve to decide if you accept or reject. This is an interesting method because first you are rejecting less. The area encloses better the curve, so you're rejecting less. But also you can tune it for efficiency or tune it for memory. If you have more rectangles, then it is gonna be more efficient, but you need to store the x and y values of the rectangles, so you need more memory to run it. Inverting the CDF is very standard. You compute the CDF and you store the values, the x values of the CDF. And then you sample a uniform point between 0 and 1. You do a binary search on your list to find where the x point value is, and that's what you return, the x value corresponding to that value here. And finally, the NUC-TR algorithm is a little bit different. In a pre-computation step, let's suppose A, B, and C are the integers that you are supposed to return. Then, and these are the probability that each of those is returned. So this is the binary representation. And based on that binary representation, you compute a binary tree where there's a leaf for each one in the binary representation of the integer. So for example, this one corresponds to this leaf here. This one corresponds to the leaf B here. And then you have two ones on the third level that corresponds to these two leaves. When you're going to sample, you sample uniform bits at each level. And using that bit, you traverse the tree until you hit a leaf. And this is guaranteed to sample exactly that distribution defined by those points. And so here are some numbers comparing the performance of each of those methods. So rejection sampling is very slow, but it has a very low memory requirement. And then things go, you get faster and faster, but you need more memory as you get faster. There's something I should say here. This is possible. You can use all these methods when the Gaussian is narrow, when your parameter for your Gaussian is very small. But for the large parameter used for key generation, that value of S, the memory will be huge for at least for the last two methods. So you're stuck with doing rejection sampling for large parameters. Okay, for our experiments, then we use NUC-TR, which is the fastest. So now let's move to the experimental results comparing the encryption schemes. So this is our implementation of PNE. Here are the parameters, the bit security, key sizes, and running times. So the first thing we did after we got these results was to compare them to NTRU to see how close they were to NTRU. We got data from Security and Innovation Incorporated, from the company, and we compared them. And we noticed that we are 100 times slower and 100 times larger key sizes. We realized that there was no hope on optimizing and getting somewhere close. So we moved on to the next obvious question is, how far are we then from a ring-LWE scheme, from LPR? So we compared then to LPR. And PNE is still much slower than LPR, and it requires much larger keys. So I want you to notice one of the things that immediately it's interesting is that the N values are much larger for PNE than for LPR. And the reason for that is the bit security. The bit security forces us to choose much larger values of N to compensate for lower bit security. And And that then drags everything down. So then you have here, I don't know, 20 kilobytes on the public key against 1.6. And then you have an encryption time of 12 against 2.36. Another thing I want you to know, I should tell, is that our implementation of LPR here is very comparable to the implementation of PNE. So we adapted an implementation by Godfrey et al, and we made them very similar so that we used exactly the same libraries, and we chose parameters in a similar way so that the worst true average case reduction holds, and we made sure that the error rate was comparable. We made them really, really comparable. So here you can really say that these two implementations are totally at the same level. So here are the same data, just on a graph. Encryption time and key sizes for the three schemes against bit security. Just to give you an idea of where we are. This is a good moment to talk about a related work by Boss et al. They implemented a homomorphic encryption version of this Provably secure NTRU, and they say, they report that their PNE implementation is about 10 times faster than an implementation of Brakersky and Vykunathan scheme, which is very related, very closely related to LPR. So why is it that they are reporting that scheme is 10 times faster and we're saying quite the opposite? Well, they say they do better hardware and better software optimizations. That's one thing, but there are other issues. So one is that for homomorphic encryption, you need a large modulus. And you need a large modulus both in the PNE scheme and in the LPR-based scheme, or LPR scheme. So you need large Q in both of them. And so it might be that that PNE is efficient as a homomorphic encryption scheme, but in our case, when it is a standalone, you can lower the modulus much more for LPR. But also, the scheme they implement supports only one level of multiplication, while they were comparing to a scheme that supports four levels of multiplication. So I don't think that's very fair. They don't say anything about that. Finally, so why is it that PNE is so inefficient? Let's look at the differences between the schemes. So for once, operations are performed modulo x to the n plus 1 instead of x to the n minus 1. Q is chosen to be a prime instead of a power of 2. C is computed this way instead of being computed this way. And then F and G are sampled from a discrete Gaussian parameter S with a very large S. Now, the first three differences cannot be decisive. The reason is because they are shared both by PNE and LPR. LPR has also very similar structure. So that cannot be what makes it so inefficient. So it must be the last one, that F and G are sampling from a discrete Gaussian very large parameter S. And why is that? Well, if you choose a very large S, from the correctness we saw that this expression has to be small with respect to Q. So you are forced to choose a large Q. And then a large Q affects the security, affects the running time, of course. The key sizes and running times are all proportional to log Q. Yes, that's one issue, but there's even a more decisive impact in the security. The security is affected in a negative way by a large Q. As we saw, the log of T is proportional to 1 over log Q. So you're forced to choose a very, by choosing a large Q, you get a very small security, and then you're forced to choose a very large N. And a very large N then makes the scheme much less efficient in many other ways, because the encryption time and the key size are proportional to N directly. So it is a little bit counterintuitive to think that a large Q has a negative effect on the security, because a large Q means a larger key space. But it is really the main dragging force behind the inefficiency of PNE. Thank you.